the official launch of the SANCOP Africa Summit. So you are at the right place at the right time. Thank you for making the decision to be here. Now, someone very dear to us left us last year, so we'd like to pay a small tribute to her. I'd like to invite Ariel to share a little bit about her.
Good morning. So for those of you who haven't been aware, a dear friend of ours, Sherry Baron-Bosch, who is the president and CEO of the U.S. Africa Development Foundation, passed earlier this year after a long battle with breast cancer. So I would just like us to take a moment of silence in respect for her. Thank you. Sherry was a longtime supporter of the SANCOP Forum. She genuinely believed in what we do here and in entrepreneurship for and by Africans. At the end of the last SANCOP Forum, we had an open forum for feedback and for conversation. And Sherry's most relevant feedback and the hardest one to take was that last year we were really running behind time that caused a lot of issues. So this year we are absolutely set on keeping on time. So we do hope that all of our speakers, our moderators, and our attendees will follow along in this effort so that we can really give Sherry the tribute that she deserves and fulfill her last request to the SANCOP Forum. So thank you all, and I'm sure we'll all keep Sherry in our prayers. Thanks. Thank you, Aria. Bimal Shah unfortunately could not join us this morning. However, he conveys his sincere wishes to you all. A thank you note to our partners, without whom this event would not have taken place. Thank you, everyone. So a quick introduction. My name is Nina Duo. I'm a founder of several businesses here in Kenya. I run an online platform called linaconnect.com, that's L-I-N-A, connect.com, where I share inspiring stories about business and life in Africa and provide coaching services to early entrepreneurs. For the last 10 years, I've been a media and marketing professional, working for KTN as a TV host, and then ventured into branding and business consulting. I was the head of communications for the biggest ethical brand in the world, Fairtrade Africa, so social entrepreneurship is important to me. I was managing 50 countries in Africa and 3 in the Middle East. Thereafter, I served as the marketing director for Easy Taxi, the world's largest taxi hailing app with a presence in 420 cities. Do you have internet access? Do you know the password? Okay. Now you have internet access. We have volunteers from all over the world who are quickly going to give you the password right now. The hashtag for the summit is SANCOP Africa. You can tweet, take pictures, share your thoughts of the events unfolding. If you like to observe, follow SANCOP Forum or follow me, linaconnect.com, so that you can get a live feed of the event's highlights. Nisha Dutt, the CEO of IntelliCup Services, the organizers of this event, will be telling us something about the amazing content, articulate speakers, and engaging activities we have to look forward to this year. Before she does, a little insight on why this conference matters. This event is considered by some as the fastest growing inclusive development platform for entrepreneurs, investors, innovators, donors, and corporations. It's the third summit in Africa, and the quest is to continue interesting conversations on entrepreneurship, innovation, and inclusive development.
This year's conversations revolve around the theme of spurring entrepreneurship economy. The SunCup Global Summit will take place in April in Mumbai. Meanwhile, Nisha, are you ready?
This morning, I want to talk to you about why it is important, why the conversation around entrepreneurship is so important to do now, why and how can all of us contribute to this conversation. And one of the best things is that, like I said, we have 25 plus people, countries represented here. There is a reason why that's happening, because I think the global attention suddenly is on Africa. I would urge you to sort of, you know, the slides are running there. I don't know if you can see it, but the stars are, so we feel that stars are aligned for Africa. There are four key trends that we have seen that are really, you know, putting Africa on the cusp of exponential growth. The first is population. Your population is growing quite rapidly. And more importantly, it's a young population that's growing. The demographic dividend that you are creating is huge at this moment. The second trend that we are seeing is rapid urbanization. The third major trend that we are talking about is poverty reduction. Actually, the World Bank recently released a report that talks about how poverty is getting reduced all across the world. And finally, regional integration. We are seeing a lot of strong trading blocs actually emerge, both in East and West Africa, very similar to the ASEAN bloc that we have seen, you know, emerge as a very powerful center. But one of the things, you know, sometimes it's difficult for us to grasp the scale of change. And I'd like to draw your attention to a fact that when I talk about rapid urbanization, today when we think of Africa, we think of a lot of rural populations and rural economies. In 3 decades, it's slated to change dramatically. In three decades from now, 60 to 70% of African population will be living in cities. And that's the scale of change that we are staring at. But you know, as good as the change is, and as good as we always talk about, you know, GDP growth and economic growth, but one of the lessons that we have learned actually from India, from other economies, is that when you have very rapid GDP and economic growth, it's not always equitable and just. It doesn't reach, generally we have seen the inequity in societies actually increases. So just to give you an example, in India we went through a very rapid economic growth between 1990s to, you know, it's still continuing. But what we saw was somewhere in, after a decade of growth, we had about, India was still home to 2/3 of world's, you know, poor population. And we still had, you know, and we also had managed to create the 6th center for global billionaires in the world. And the inequities was greater than ever. So this is one thing that, you know, this is something that we need to keep in mind as we grow our economies, to make sure that you are inclusive, that the growth is inclusive and you are taking everyone along. And one of the reasons why inclusive growth is so important is because it creates resilience in economies. We have seen that if you want to create eventually, you know, political resilience, if you want to create economic resilience, community level, environmental resilience, you have to create inclusive economies. So that's one of the biggest lessons that we have learned. And one thing that's sort of exciting about it, you know, the reason I'm stressing on this point is because we went through this cycle in India. We have seen this cycle being repeated in Southeast Asia. But you have a unique opportunity because you are sitting on the cusp of that growth. You have this opportunity to change this equation. It doesn't have to be that way, actually. You can build resilience in economies. And one of the best ways we have seen is supporting entrepreneurship, because entrepreneurs are the people that are going to support, you know, you locally. They are going to, you know, catalyze local economies. So that's why entrepreneurship is so critical, actually, to support, to build resilience. I've often seen that this kind of relationship is not made very easily. People don't relate. Entrepreneurship is building resilience. But over years, in our experience, we have seen that's one of the critical, you know, catalytic factors that has emerged. So one of the, so when you're stared with, you know, such big problems, I like what Phil Condit said once. You know, he said that when you're stared with the, you know, enormity of challenges in front of you, you have two responses, right? Fight or flight. So either you can still stick in and say, dig in your heels and say that I'm going to fight this, or you can flight. So that's why it's sort of, you know, important for us to acknowledge that the enormity of challenge is big, and we need to really sort of, you know, see what are the ways in which we can address some of this. And for IntelliCap, right, as much as we talk about entrepreneurship, another quick statistic I want to give you is that I don't know how many of you have been following the India story recently, there is a lot of social unrest going on in India right now. And it is because, you know, the core of that problem, without alluding to exact problem here, but the core of the issue is that people feel that there is, you know, inequity in societies, there is unrest, there is opportunities have not been provided to all strata. And it is now, despite 3 decades of growth for India, we are seeing a lot of social unrest. So that's why it's so important to sort of address these issues head on. It's important to address these issues when you have an opportunity and you are at the beginning of these cycles. And at IntelliCap, one of the reasons, you know, we always say that we catalyze entrepreneurial economy, but at IntelliCap, what is closer to our heart is to catalyze conscientious entrepreneurship. Because entrepreneurship for its own sake is not really enough. Conscientious entrepreneurs are the ones that design for the excluded. These are the people who take, you know, they are not extracted from the economy. They give a lot more than they extract. These are the people who actually demonstrate solutions that work. As you know, entrepreneurs are very agile, right? I mean, they may not have a lot of capital, but they have the ability to experiment on ground. So one of the things that we have seen that conscientious entrepreneurs do is they experiment with solutions on ground, and not necessarily, they may not be best ways to scale it. There is a big debate about, you know, how entrepreneurs don't scale beyond a certain level. But I think that debate, as good as it is also a little bit misplaced. Because sometimes their value is in creating the solution, in exposing and making sure that the discovery of the solution process has happened. Because you can experiment. And there are other people who can come in and sort of, you know, pick that up and scale in partnerships with you. So I think that's, again, one of the topics that we will touch upon during the summit, as to the issue of scale. And, you know, why is there so much debate about entrepreneurs not scaling eventually? So the third thing that entrepreneurs do very well is they actually create solutions that are context specific. So why do we say that entrepreneurship is so important and local? You will often see that a lot of solutions that come into emerging markets actually come from West. They actually come from outside of emerging markets. It's not bad to have a solution that works in, you know, in, I wouldn't say that there's anything wrong in that, but often the challenge is when you import solutions, they are context free. They just don't work in your context, right? So if you have a vaccine refrigerator that works, you know, absolutely beautifully in some parts of Western world, it comes and utterly fails in emerging markets. Why? It's not because the product is bad. It's because it's not been designed for the realities of the ground. And that's one thing that local entrepreneurs can do, because they are so grounded in the right context that they can create solutions that actually work for that economy. But again, you know, as much as we talk about entrepreneurship, I also will acknowledge very clearly, because we have been supporting about 1,000 entrepreneurs, that it's a difficult journey. It's really difficult. It's not easy to do this. It's easier to have a job than be an entrepreneur and provide jobs. So one of the lessons, the 3 things that I want to point to specifically in context of Africa and also what we have learned globally, there are 3 reasons why we have seen entrepreneurship doesn't scale. There are a million reasons, but of course the 3 key ones are, the first is we call it valley of death. It's actually, it happens between the ideation and go to market. Absolutely, you know, entrepreneurs are not able to take off. They have a great idea, they just don't have access to markets. That's often caused by lack of capital. It's often, and again, you know, I want to stress this a little bit, because capital gets overemphasized in all startup conversations. But in fact, as important as capital is, I think your ability to absorb capital, your ability to understand how much capital you need actually to grow your business, to make sure that you don't end up taking more money than you need, I think you need good advice as well. So we have seen that typically entrepreneurship dies in a valley of death. So for you know, there's a very big saying in India. We say that India is a graveyard of pilots. In pilot stage, everything works. Nothing works in scale. That's because when you are doing a pilot, everybody is focused on making it work, right? There is disproportionate amount of focus that is being given in terms of resources and capital to make sure that whatever I'm piloting works. But then take it to scale, all the attention goes away, the money is not there, it's not sustainable. And that's the absolute valley of death. We have seen it, and we are seeing that trend happen here. So, you know, this is first thing I want to talk to you about. The second reason why entrepreneurship doesn't scale, this is a little bit more, you know, context specific here. It's because people get used to soft money. They don't want to build businesses. They want to raise money. One message if I want to give entrepreneurs is that your business is to create a business. Your business is not to raise money. If you start losing focus and start running chasing money, if you start raising grants, soft money ruins business like nothing else, because it makes you sluggish. It makes you, you know, not responsive to the challenges in front of you. And that's the second big reason we have seen why entrepreneurs often fail. The third big reason I want to point to you point is that consumer markets, right? You are so import reliant that you don't want to. So even if there's an entrepreneur in front of you with a great product, you don't want to buy their product. You actually, so one is, you know, how entrepreneurs themselves kill themselves. But I think it's also a lot of us in this room kill entrepreneurship. Because if I feel that every time you go to supermarket and buy a product, you are voting with your wallet. And every time you don't buy local and you buy something, you know, which is imported, you are killing entrepreneurship. So I would really urge you to buy local. Vote with your, and you have a very strong vote. All consumers have vote. You vote with your wallet. So that's on the conception. But again, you know, like I said, the reason, so we have discovered the reasons why entrepreneurship doesn't work, but we have also discovered what can make it maybe, you know, click. And one of that is you really need to create supportive ecosystems. Ecosystems that entrepreneurs can rely on. And at IntelliCap, if there's one thing that we do for the decade and a half in that we have been in existence, we have been building entrepreneurial ecosystems. That's just the core of what we do. This is what we have spent our life doing. So the way it works for us, or the way we have processed this, is through confluence of what I call knowledge, capital, and networks. Knowledge, like I was referring to, that you need knowledge, you need to understand the power of your idea, first of all, right? How good is your idea? Does your idea really have market? Is it the next big thing? So to bring that knowledge into the ecosystem, that are you doing something new? Is it more of lift or shift? Is it faster, better, cheaper? What are you doing with your product in the first place? So that's first part. The second is capital. So capital, you know, money does make the world go around as much as we, you know, we want to deny it. But in terms of capital, what we have been able to do in IntelliCap is, if you are an entrepreneur that needs $75, we have the ability to give it to you. If you need 20 million, we can actually lend to you. So at IntelliCap, we have created both equity and debt arms. So we have our own equity capital. We also give debt to entrepreneurs. But more importantly, we understand that our capital is not enough. So we leverage a lot of other capital. And just in those, in that, just to give you a number, we have facilitated about 1 billion in investments in the last 1 year, in the last 15 years. And finally, networks. This is very important. Network is what we provide to entrepreneurs, because you can have capital, you can have advice, but if nobody knows you exist, you are going to die anyways. So that's one of the reasons why we are here today, right? Sankalp is our way of convening platform where we said that there are two things that we want to do. One is we definitely want to give entrepreneurs the center stage so that investors and other people can see them. The second is, can we convene global discourse on inclusive development? This is something that I'm assuming is very dear to all of us in this room. So can we shape the conversation for the next decade? What should those conversations be, really, right? And what's happening? So to bring some honesty into that. So that's why we created this network of Sankalp. So what we have done is about 1,000 plus partners and attendees come every year and sort of have conversations on, you know, what is next, what needs to be invested in. And it's a two-way communication. Entrepreneurs are able to see investors, and investors are able to tell you and give you messages as to what is it that's exciting to them. Unidirectional flow, I'm hoping that we can make it, you know, bi-directional. So that's a third change that really needs to happen. So that's the kind of, so our effort is to make sure that we can create that ecosystem here. So, and one of the questions that people often ask us is that, where do you draw boundaries, right? Where does a global ecosystem stop and where does the local one pick up? To be very honest, we haven't found very clean answers. I'm hoping that with conversations with a lot of you, we'll find it in the next two days. But really, at least what we know right now is that global ecosystems are needed for initial capital. They are needed for proven solutions. They are definitely needed for larger markets, right? So these are the three places where you use global capital. But where do you switch and, you know, say that the local ecosystem needs to come into play? It's for opportunity identification. You may have the solution, but the opportunity identification must happen locally. The businesses must be driven locally. The second is sourcing ventures. You know, I know a lot of investors are in the room. There is private equity, venture capital. If there's one feedback that we have gotten, and which is, you know, constant, is that how do I go and source ventures on the ground? I don't know which ones are good. That has to be driven locally. Fly in, fly out doesn't work. That's a local ecosystem. What took us 2 decades to do in India should take you only a decade to do. If we aren't able to mobilize and, you know, if we aren't able to really achieve that, we haven't really done much then with our time and effort. So that's one thing that at Sankalp Platform we are very, very focused towards. That's our number one goal. Bring transfer learning and create a truly global South-South platform. Can we curate conversations between, you know, India, Southeast Asia, Africa? Can we start, you know, doesn't matter what it is. We are going to change the world in our lifetimes. I know it doesn't sound, it's sometimes cliched, but it's the only belief that keeps us going. So I leave you with that, and I actually look forward to meeting most of you over the next 2 days. So thank you for joining us, and I'm honored to have you here.
And is too much money encouraging a culture of mediocrity in Africa? Andrea Chakaba, Suleiman Kigundu, Neva Sharma, Hugh Scott, and Mark Karato are getting ready to tell us why one of Africa's biggest problems has to do with having too much rather than too little money. Andrea Chakaba is the co-founder and MD of Alpha Africa Asset Managers. Fun fact, she has managed assets worth over $1 billion. Suleiman Kigundu is the regional director for Africa CDC Group. He's right over here. Nivi Sharma is the president of BRCK Education. Hugh Scott, the director of AECF, over there. And Mark Karato is the chief, Office of Economic Growth, USA, Kenya, and East Africa. They are the panelists for this conversation that will be moderated by Nivi Sharma. I leave you in her capable hands.
Okay, thank you very much. So I'm going to preface the session by applying the Chatham House rule and saying that we've got a lot of interesting things to say, and I'd like our panelists to really say what they're thinking and not have their opinions either attributed to them or the organization that they represent here, or that don't represent, as they're representing their own views. So let's start off with 2 to 3 minute introductions and opening remarks. And so the panel discussion is too much soft money encouraging a culture of mediocrity in Africa? And again, I'm going to preface the session by saying that neither of the panelists are absolutely for or against, but they are going to put some interesting questions on the table. So on my left and your right, there is Mark. No, sorry, we haven't sat in property. Okay, so Andia and Suleiman, who are gonna argue for, and they're coming from the hard money side of the table. And then we have Hugh and Mark, who are gonna be arguing against, saying that soft money isn't all bad. So Andia, do you wanna kick us off with introductions and an opening remark about the conversation?
Morning. So my name's Andy Chakava, and I'm the co-founder of Alpha Africa Asset Managers. We're basically a fund, a multi-asset class manager. So we look at fixed income. We're currently developing our listed equity offering, and we do quite a bit of advisory work for both foreign and local investors that are looking to deploy money. Sectors of expertise are financial services, education, and agri-processing. As we sit and talk about the topic today, I think I also have two hats, because I do quite a bit of work with New Faces, New Voices, and we work with women entrepreneurs looking to see how we can help them raise capital. But when I look and I base it on our experiences just being an institutional investor, the rules simply do not change because it's Africa, or because entrepreneurs are working under very difficult conditions. When people look at businesses and they want to invest in a business, they have a primary return focus. And the money has an opportunity cost. The money could go to a different asset class, It could go to a different sector. It actually doesn't really need to be deployed to that particular entity. So it is competitive, and the case needs to be compelling. In addition to that, the business not only needs to have a high return, it needs to be scalable, and it needs to have the right governance structures to support it. It is my understanding, and from what I see, some of the businesses that have been supported with this kind of gentle, patient, soft, however we want to put it, are possibly not ready for the real world, not ready for the time that they have to scale up and interact with these investors that are going to demand these particular requirements from them. There is also a tendency when people back a business, they back a person, but it goes beyond the person, so there has to be a succession plan. So it's not just about having a good idea or entering into a field that's quite noble. It is this something that can be replicated, and there are other people that can actually do this particular job? And we found that sometimes some of the money available seems to be faddish, and it requires also entrepreneurs to change their behavior. So if everybody suddenly is a technology lover because there's a lot of global interest in technology or renewable energy, then we're moving away from the sort of businesses being filled to create a gap and to be sustainable, and not necessarily having people forming initiatives to chase the money. So while we say soft money might be there, I think the notion is the future is not soft money, and it perpetuates the notion that entrepreneurship in Africa still needs to be supported and cannot stand on its two feet. Yet Africa is known to have very many successful entrepreneurs that have navigated through these circumstances and have basically run businesses in their own right. Our fund is funded by one such entrepreneur, which is the founder of Family Bank.
Okay, interesting. So soft money is almost condescending. And the other person who's going to argue for the side is Suleiman.
Okay, Suleiman Kigundu from CDC. So given the prominence that the other CDC, we are not the Center for Disease Control, but actually the former Commonwealth Development Corporation, which has been investing in Africa for over 70 years, both in direct investments as well as supporting the private equity space in Africa and the rest of the globe. CDC at this juncture supports a little over 700 companies in Africa, directly and indirectly, with a portfolio of close to $3 billion. So we are investors that span the whole spectrum. We have the patient capital, we have the hard-nosed money, and so we have had experience in both sides, and we do see that there is a role for soft money, but there is also, as Andile has alluded to, a need to make sure that that money graduates to be able to play in the more traditional venture space. Just by way of background, because we are actually looking at this more in our personal capacities rather than as institutions, because as you know, where money is scarce, no one wants to offend. So I think it's best that I put it in personal capacity. So if I offend anyone, it's personal, it's not institutional. I spent 10 years working across Africa with HSBC in the commercial and investment banking. I then spent another 10 years building a boutique investment banking group, which provides both capital markets, private equity, and also advisory work across Africa. And I've spent the last few years helping CDC re-engage in Africa as we look to deploy capital both through private equity as well as through direct equity and loans. So, I mean, Andile has given a good preface of what sort of the debate's about. I think we need to spend a lot of the time just sort of engaging. And I would say that we had a third panelist, I think, for our side in Nisha, whose statements I think very clearly also sort of alluded to where soft money is. I think, as we said, soft money does have a place to play, but I think it is the expectations and what is measured when people think about soft money. They automatically, connotation and perception is that it moves away from financial returns, from financial sustainability towards some sort of developmental impact. While developmental impact is important, sustainability can only be achieved through financial viability. So I think when we look at it, we need to understand what it is that we're trying to achieve. If we're trying to achieve businesses that simply survive because of soft money, that is a different ecosystem. I think from an African perspective, entrepreneurs are not looking for charity. They're looking for, and I think we had an award recipient yesterday who highlighted that you cannot empower someone. All you can do is help someone empower themselves. What entrepreneurs are looking for is for the platform and the framework to develop their ideas into concretized, profitable ventures that could, by being profitable in ventures, to also have a good social impact and development. So I'll leave it there to open up for the rest of the panel.
Okay. And from the soft money corner, we have Hugh from AEDC, but Hugh actually works for KPMG and manages their fund.
I hope it's all right, but I'm going to stand up. I have this aversion to speaking when I'm sitting down. And this is a debate, after all. And if I remember the House of Commons, which we have a previous member of in the audience, that when the Prime Minister is speaking, he's standing up. And when the head of the opposition is speaking, he's standing up. So I'm going to stand up, if that's okay. I'm not going to talk about what I do. I'm the director of the Africa Enterprise Challenge Fund. I'm here in my personal capacity, so I'm going to park that. And I want to tell you a little hypothetical story, if you'll just bear with me. I want you to imagine that we have a group of donor agencies sitting down in a room with a series of government ministers from around Africa talking about the challenges of development and how they can spur development. And once again, they come back to the old cherry and say, you know, the majority of our poor people in rural areas, and we really got to do something for the small farming community and the rural areas in Africa, because that's where we've got to increase the incomes of the poor, and that's where we've got to create jobs. And they were discussing this thing, and you know, normally they've done things with the government or whatever, and he said, you know, these days everyone's talking about forming partnerships with the business sector. Maybe we should do something like that. So they put together $750 million. It's a lot of money. And they say, right, well, we don't know how to do this, but we're going to have three different goals. We're going to put $250 million into this, $250 million into this, and $250 million into this. And in 10 years' time, we're going to go back and measure which of those routes has created the most jobs, which of those routes has increased the income of the largest number of people, and by what? Because their objective is helping poor people. Their objective is jobs and income. So what are those three routes that it chose? Well, first of all, it went to the banking sector. And it went to a major bank in Africa and said, we've got $250 million here. You can take this money from us. We, as long as you invest it or provide debt capital and loans to agribusinesses across the continent. In 10 years' time, we want to see what's happened with that portfolio and how you've got on. And, you know, these days everyone's telling us that returnable capital is very important. So we're not going to charge you any interest, but please, at the end of that, we want our money back. But you can make that available to the commercial sector, to businesses, on commercial interest rates and make as much money as you want. Then they go to the other second choice. That's an impact investor. And they say to the impact investor, here's $250 million. You've got that, over 10 years, we're going to come back and see what you've done. As long as you invest it with the private sector, but it's got to be an agribusiness, whatever. Thank you. And the third one is a development fund. And they give that development fund $250 million, and they say the same thing. That money must support agribusiness, but we're going to come back and see what's happened after 10 years. When they came back, what did they find? They went to the bank and said, how'd you get on? The bank had a big smile on his face. He said, here's your $250 million. Here it is. You asked for it back, you've got it back. What did you do with it? Well, it was quite difficult, really. You know, we were very worried. This is hard currency. And, you know, we just had a lot of trouble finding deals. But in the end, you know, what we found out is that we're financing agribusiness trade. That was okay. But we've been doing that before. But thanks very much, you know. And then the evaluator said, well, has your portfolio really changed? And they said, not really. Yeah? And did you really lend to people you wouldn't have lent to before? No, we lent to the same people we would have done anyway. So what was the net benefit in development terms from the $250 million commercial money provided to the bank? Actually, quite little. And they went to the impact investor and asked the same question. The impact investor is an impact investor. It understands, it's looking for impact. But finding the deals was a problem. $250 million is a lot of money to invest and actually to take equity and to deal with it. They got there. It took them 6 years to fund 30 deals that used up the money. Of those 30 deals, a number failed, as you'd expect, a number reasonable. They got a few flyers, and they basically did a pretty good job. Yeah? And the impact, well, the impact wasn't too bad, and they've left some businesses behind. Then they went to the development fund and said, what did you do with the $250 million? And the development fund said, we ran some competitions for the private sector. You did what? Yeah, we took your money and we made it available out there to the private sector, and we asked the private sector to bid for that money. Oh yeah, and how did you decide who to give it to? Well, we set criteria which said, the business, you've got to be capable of running this. We're not in business development. You've got to be capable of implementing your project that you're putting up. And number two, you've got to demonstrate to us that your business idea is profitable, sustainable, and can grow. Then we would look at it and say, well, two things. One, would a bank have funded that or not? If the answer is yes, this development fund says we won't fund it. If the answer to that is no, therefore this money is really additional, yes, they're going to fund it. And what was the other core criteria? What was the development impact going to be? So assuming all other things equal, commercially viable, capacity to implement, etc., then we picked the businesses that have the biggest development impact. Okay, and how many of those did you give money to? Or what did you do? We selected 240 businesses and invested an average of $750,000 in each one of those businesses, but as a grant. We provided them a matching grant, and we said to those businesses, you can have that money, but you've got to match us at least a dollar to a dollar. Did they match? Actually, they matched 3-1. So we ended up with $750 million in those 240 businesses. Which of those solutions do you think gave the biggest results? And you're all going to say, the development fund, I hope. The message I'm trying to put across here is the answer to that is not that necessarily. The issue is, what do you want to achieve? What is your objective? If your objective is to create jobs and have incomes increase to poor people, then you look at your vehicle, your investment vehicle, whatever you want to do, and you then put it where you get the biggest return. If your ambition is about building businesses, if it's about entrepreneurship, which this is about, and we have no objection, I'm not saying it's bad, then it's a different solution. So the issue is, be clear. The message from me is this. Be clear what your objective is, and then make your decision about whether you should use soft money or whether you should use hard money, and in what way you do it. Okay? That's my message. Thank you very much. And by the way, the third example was the ACF. The numbers are from the ACF.
Okay. And Mark from USA.
No, thanks. I'm Mark Carano. I'm our Chief of Economic Growth here in USAID and East Africa. In practical terms, that means we manage a portfolio. It's the presidential initiative to feed the future of Power Africa, so agriculture and energy. We do work in resilience, which is basically feed the future type stuff, in ASEL areas, the arid, semi-arid lands of Kenya. We manage a finance portfolio, innovation, and entrepreneurship. So we're kind of across the board. When Nidhi called me and told me I was on the side of subsidy or soft money, I'm like, not really. And I kind of hedged at it, and I kind of thought, well, I'm going to be the lamest person, because I'm not going to fight, because I heard some of the words, some of my opposition says return of scalable, competitive, market driven, like check. Absolutely. So I think to some extent, everything we do as the USAID is subsidy. So whether you want to look at it as a direct soft money grant, one end of the spectrum, all the way through, we subsidize. We're there purposely with a development objective, as Hugh said. So I was thinking to myself, you know, in the world of sound bites, how would I put that on a bumper sticker? And I could say, subsidy and proud. That doesn't really quite get it. So I thought something along the lines of subsidy to catalyze and accelerate growth for targeted sectors to overcome non-market barriers and proud. So really that's what we try to do. So we have a very large, complex portfolio, and we hit this at all kinds of levels. And I'm proud, even looking in the crowd, I see some of our partners, businesses that we invest in through an incubator. I see some of our partners that are subcontractors on some of our larger contracts, where we definitively want the idea of the private sector to grow its ability to serve. I see some of our partners in here, even an honorary last night, Development Credit Authority agreement with us, Renewable Energy, the Kenyan Women's Finance Trust. MCOPA got some of their initial money from our Development Credit Authority. So there's a lot of subsidized money out there. I would definitely not disagree with the idea that just giving someone a whole bunch of money to do something that would never survive in the market is a good thing. Absolutely not. I mean, I'm sure you, as soon as I say this, I'm sure someone's going to come out with a great example, but I would challenge anyone to look at AIDS portfolio and say, that's what we do. We do not do that. We believe in all the same tenets as everyone else. Absolutely needs to be a private sector-driven approach. That said, appropriate soft money and or subsidies can target certain development objectives we have. We want entrepreneurs, for sure. But we also want entrepreneurs to work in Wajir. We also want entrepreneurs who are women. We also want entrepreneurs who do certain things in renewable energy. There's certain reasons we try to target. And if my subsidy can help that business grow in 5 years instead of 25 years, absolutely, it's a good investment. It's a good investment for me in my bottom line, and hopefully a good investment for that company, because my soft money didn't prop up a non-market-driven solution, it accelerated a market-driven solution. And that's what we try to do across the board. So whether we do it by supporting a telecap and looking at the incubators and intermediaries, whether we do it often, not so often at a very enterprise level, though we do that too at times, we're trying to make sure that happens. Someone made a point about failure, about soft money can ruin companies. I don't disagree. However, I think from a development standpoint, failure happens on both sides. Failure of a wrong soft money that wrecked the company is bad. Failure without the appropriate subsidy for a company that could have been the next big thing because it didn't have the ability to grow in a very challenging ecosystem with poor regulatory environment, with very poor clients who can't do cash flow, and we all know cash flow is the key. You can afford many mortgages, but if you can't make the cash work all along the way, you can never pay off the house. If that person fails because I couldn't have been there, or ASAP couldn't have been there, or CC couldn't have been there, that's a failure too. That's the counterfactual and the opportunity cost we're out to do, and none of us can pick and say exactly know where to walk that line. Too much soft money, you ruined them. Not enough soft money, we didn't know who you were, you never existed, and therefore you never did the development impact you could have had. So I think it's a very interesting conversation. It really depends on where you want to put your point. So I guess I'm for subsidy for sure. I'm against bad soft money that is market distorted. Mm-hmm. I hope that puts me on one side or the other.
Sure, I think you know, it's not about soft money or hard money. There's always bad money, and there's going to be anecdotes about soft money starting up something like M-Pesa or M-Copa, and that's a huge success. There's anecdotes about hard money starting really great sustainable ventures, and they're doing well. And there's anecdotes on the other side. And unfortunately, no one on this panel I know has any data about what's working in terms of soft versus hard money. So the debate itself is a little bit of a fallacy. But I do want to, you know, point out that all of us are sitting on three different sides of the table. And very few people, even in this room, have sat on all three sides. And that's as a donor, as an investor, or as an entrepreneur. And the language with which we're speaking to each other is very different. So I'm going to do a quick game before we launch into some questions, because I do want to hear what the audience is. So if you could get your pen and a piece of paper, I'm going to say a word, and I want each of you to write down the first thing that comes to mind. All right? The kind of people, the kind of things that come to mind. All right? Let's start with impact. Andia, what do you have?
It needs to be measurable.
Measurable?
Large.
Investment?
Development.
Interesting. Intervention?
Cushion?
Careful.
Targeted.
Process.
Process?
Yeah.
Okay. Stakeholders. What's that with cinnamon?
Investors.
Investors? India?
Government.
Government.
Business.
Business?
The whole ecosystem.
Ecosystem. All right. And finally, capacity. Mark?
Needed.
Needed? Hugh?
To deliver.
To deliver. Andia?
Team.
Mm-hmm.
Measurable.
Measurable. So it's unfortunate that we weren't sitting soft against hard. But like, you know, we're really speaking different languages and we use different words and different things are coming to mind about what these mean and just, and when we are speaking different languages, then it's hard to bring soft money to a hard-nosed entrepreneur who wants to make ends meet and do the kind of thing that scenario one in your example we're talking about. So for me, it's a really difficult thing to start figuring out how we're all going to work together in this ecosystem and have big, large impact and meet the kind of goals and decipher the kind of goals that the money is coming to us from. And that's an important thing. So should I start with a question for Suleiman? You mentioned once, you know, it's about picking winners, right? So, you know, what is your strategy with that? When you think of it from a hard money point of view.
Wow. Well, thanks for the question. Interesting. Trying to maybe flip it a little bit on its head, in that I think one of my colleagues here said that it's about, for them, it's about starting the race rather than picking the winner. Mm-hmm. And I think it goes back to, again, I think fundamentally the question is, you, as Jack Welch once said, you get what you measure. Mm-hmm. So it's really about deciding what is the ultimate objective and then what measures do you put in place to measure to make sure that those objectives are being met. And I think when we're looking at this this whole environment, this question and saying, well, where are you putting your money, what have you, I think the issue around does soft money create mediocrity or does it stimulate mediocrity, I think we have recognized here that some measurable, focused soft money is very beneficial, it's catalytic, and it's required. I think what we're finding is that, on the other hand, is that there are a lot of people who go out there and simply say, oh, this has the potential to reach 10,000 people, you give them the money, you basically then wake up and say, did it get to 10,000 people? Great, job well done. Whether it's sustainable has not been measured. Whether it's created a better system, processes, ability for people to actually take the next step forward has not been done. So I think it is also very much about when we look at saying where you're putting money in, how you're achieving it, it's like, well, what are the objectives of the managers and the person that you're supporting? Do they have a vested interest in its success, or do they have a vested interest in just receiving the money? As they say, nothing ventured, nothing gained. So whether it's matching the money that's put in, or whether it's the sweat equity or what have you, you have to make sure that they're invested somehow, so that their efforts are also underpinning their participation in that venture. I think we need to look at and understand, well, what processes are you stimulating and encouraging? A number of projects, especially around soft money, are very good at measuring and reporting on the number of people we have impacted, the number of people we have engaged with, what have you. When you start telling them, well, okay, can you tell me where this money's gone? Can you actually produce a set of accounts that are traditional and understandable for other people to say, now we want to wean you off and get you into the other place, you'll find that that is not available. So I think we are looking at saying, how do you invest putting in processes, systems, monitoring and reporting to actually build capacity for someone to be sustainable, for someone to move beyond basically the helping hand. Basically, how do you help someone empower themselves?
Okay. So Mark, I know this isn't exactly what you do, but are you aware of the opposite of that? That soft money that's being given without measures or objectives, and have you seen, you know, what has that done? Does it spur innovation? Does it give entrepreneurs some breathing room to go and pivot and do more interesting things? Or does it just end up being, you know, encouraging mediocrity and being money badly spent?
We don't do it, so I'm not going to be able to speak from experience. No, I mean, I'm going to take Suleiman's approach here and pivot this a little bit as well. No, yeah, I've seen, we've all seen poor development programs. Mm-hmm. You know, I think all development agencies have grown over time, and, you know, I think, well, what's a great example? Sedalia is sitting in the second row here. They're a partner of ours. It's a private sector solution to try to bring agro inputs and extension to ASAL areas, so Marsa, Turkana, Siolo, so forth. It's a hard place to work, right? So we could go up there, and one thing we did over years, and why we now work with people like Sedai, and why our administrator years ago when he came here said, okay, how much money has the U.S. government put into humanitarian aid because of drought? A lot of money. And there's a need for that. I'm not going to say that there's not a need to do that kind of work. There absolutely is. When you have an acute emergency, you take acute measures and you make sure you save lives. But over time, do we want to keep putting in humanitarian aid in the tens of millions of dollars all the time? No, we don't. We want sustainable development foreign solutions. So over time, we started what's called our resilience efforts in parts of Ethiopia and Kenya, where we take from our Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance all the way through my portfolio to figure out ways that over time, we make sure it's a sustainable solution for entrepreneurs, among others, to come in and find market-driven solutions to help a very difficult place, right? So we could have continued, I suppose, to give Christy a whole bunch of free money. We don't. She has a lot of deliverables. I'm sure it's not easy to work for USAID, by the way. We have lots of rules, lots of regulations. We definitely demand certain kinds of rigor in terms of our evaluations and so forth that isn't necessarily easy or inexpensive, I should say, for people to do. So we try to figure out ways to do it. So we're looking forward. I guess one point I want to throw out there too for the group to think about is, like, and I think it was Hugh who brought it up, a little bit of a challenge the other direction. The speed and scale of which the challenge for us to figure out some of the problems that development agencies worry doesn't mean all the talent's here. It absolutely is. But all the stuff we want to do it fast. We really want to do it as fast as possible. And so I think that's where scaling happens. So if I can bring 100 companies to scale instead of 3, because the way I work allows me to do it, and that's a good thing. That should be my part of the ecosystem. And other people have other parts of the ecosystem. And at the end of the day, we're all going to make progress, right? So we're looking at this in a new for future programming, and we ask the world through a process we have called Request for Information, what should we do? If I have X number of dollars, do I got them put into a fund? Or here's what you're telling me all the time when I come out and I go to things like this, is that the money's out there, social impact investors, the equity partners, the debt, I have a development credit authority where I underwrite risk on portfolios for lending. There's a lot of money out there. But people don't want to pay for TA, technical assistance, and people need it, especially if they want to catalyze quicker businesses. People don't necessarily want to pay for transaction advisory services. So, you know, I was on the jury last night with Suleiman, and we had some really good companies there. There's no doubt all of them could benefit from some people who really know how to run a business along the way and say, did you think about that? Did you think about this pitfall? Did you even see this coming? Transaction advisory services. There's no doubt that people on my end, and I think a lot of us would like to see if these models are working. So we need to test them. We need rigor. We need counterfactuals. We need blind pilots. Also very expensive to do, right? So maybe my money goes to those areas. If I can work with you to find new patient capital and new social investor and new equity partner and new bank, and I can help figure out a way to smartly put that money together, be that catalyst, and I can provide the TA because I can afford to do it, and you won't because your returns won't look good. And I can provide some transaction advisory services. And at the end of it, I'll happily measure it. And we all work together. Man, that to me is an ecosystem. And that's got subsidy, right? That's got soft money. So I'll stop there instead of saying why soft money ruins people.
Okay. So one more question from Andrea before we get to questions from the floor. So imagine, Andrea, a place like Wajir, a place like some parts of Somalia, Garissa, where there's either humanitarian aid or there is, let's say there's no soft money. Let's say there's only hard-nosed investors there. Hard-nosed investors aren't investing in entrepreneurs there, are they? So what would happen, like, if there's only humanitarian aid going to places like this? What do you imagine would happen? A world without patient capital, without impact investment?
No, I think the point is not to say that there shouldn't be any patient capital, mm-hmm. and we do know that areas that that have quite a bit of difficulty mm-hmm. also do need mechanisms to catalyze them. But what we're saying within these societies, and you can get that from the number of local entrepreneurs that have done very well and haven't relied on soft money. Has anybody asked them how they did it, why they did it? And people are basically made to survive. So what they've done, they've capitalized on a need, they've used their relationships, they've done it in a very, it's probably been longer. It probably hasn't got, in fact, a lot of the investors said to me, a lot of the entrepreneurs that are local that have made it don't want any what they call impact money. It makes them doing reporting that they can't even afford. We have to realize that from an Africa perspective, we already, a lot, even if you're working with a hard-nosed investor entrepreneur, you would have a development impact anyway. And what I'm trying to say is that when people are looking at a return portfolio, there is no dandy, there's no sympathy. They're just matrices that need to be followed. Are we building and nurturing entrepreneurs from the very beginning that understand that one day they're going to graduate? So if I'm working in a university and I create a bubble for the students and they come out there and they can't really do what needs to be done in the workplace, there will be a problem about them being employable. My argument is that this kind of money is creating a bubble that is making some of these businesses uninvestable to the institutional investors that they do need when they're going to scale up. And I talk on both sides because we kind of try and convince, but people don't change their criteria because there's a sympathetic issue happening, unfortunately.
Yeah. Hi, buddy, a round of applause for you. What do you think? Do you think it's a bubble? Do you think you're encouraging a bubble, encouraging people to not face up to the real world where money needs to be returned? And do you think money does have to be returned? I think that's some of the things that he was trying to bring out. When M-Pesa started off with soft money from DFID, they've done very well. But DFID weren't like, oh, well, give us our initial capital back, right? They didn't even expect it back.
Sure. Yeah. It's back to the same point I was making in terms of what you're trying to achieve. But at the same time, it's not as if there isn't a crossover between development and business when you're working with them, and that's the game. The one thing is for sure is that the highest correlation we have between two things going on in the ACF world is between business turnover and development impact. If business turnover is static, development impact is static too. If that business grows by 5 times, if it's the right business, we're going to increase the development impact by 5 times. So the challenge from our point of view is to choose the right business. And that wasn't easy, by the way, and I didn't mention that we've had 20,000 businesses come to us, we've had over 7,000 businesses complete full application forms and business plan, and we funded 240. You know, if we're good enough, we should be able to select some pretty good businesses that fit our criteria out of that kind of fund. And the next point I would make to Philemon's point about, you know, that you don't know what's happening, you've not proper records and financial records. Every one of those businesses we work with has to report with normal financial statements. That's the ballgame. And, you know, one of the things that we provide, if you want the money, you have to report, you have to have proper financial management systems and whatever. And what a lot of the smaller businesses do, they complain. And what do they do 3 years later? They come in with a big smile and say thank you. Why do they say thank you? They said, because we've managed to raise commercial money now, and the reason they came to us is because we've got decent books, we've got decent systems in place, and you forced us to have those decent systems in place, even though we didn't want to do it at the time. So, you know, these things aren't polarized. Yeah? There's not only what is the objective you're trying to achieve with this money, but it's how you do it. Yeah? How you do it is almost more important than what you set up to do, but you can't have one without the other. Clear what this money is for, achieving jobs and incomes for lots of people, that's great, yeah? But you've got to manage it well, and you've got to do it in the right way, and you're going to make sure you achieve those objectives. We're obviously very proud of what we've achieved. The impact was on 7.5 million people in 2014. We're very confident that 2015, when we publish our numbers, if we do publish our numbers, we'll be in excess of 10 million people benefiting. We're proud of that, and that's in partnership with the private sector. So it can be done. But equally, you know, if I'm a private person, I've got capital, I don't get returns on those capital. I'm not being asked to provide those returns. If you ask me to provide those returns, and returnable capital, is it a good idea? What is it going to do? It's going to change the business as I choose to support, number one, yeah? Because I need to make sure that I've got businesses that are going to repay me, yeah? And I'm not looking so hard at innovation and potential impact. I'm looking first at their ability to repay. That's the first thing. What's the second thing that might happen from that?
is that I start to be sought after. I'm going to pick the same businesses as the bank's going to pick. Instead of my additionality thing, which says, I only fund things banks won't fund, if you force a repayment on me and a commercial return on me, I'm going to pick exactly what the banks are doing. So instead of you think that free money might be distortionary, actually, the nearer we get to commercial money, the more distortionary we will become. Because we're going to take the same investments as others.
Yeah, I'm sure you're going to have more questions on that. So I do want to ask one more question before I open the floor. Is Mark, what's your bottom line? Like, are you looking for a return on investment? What is that one number that you say, sure, you're making impact, you're creating jobs, but I want to see a return on investment of X percentage. Do you have that?
No. My bottom line is, in my agriculture portfolio, is stunting and poverty. My bottom line in the energy portfolio is megawatts and connections.
Okay.
I mean, so we use lots of models to get there. Absolutely, we try to follow the market to get there, but I'm a development agency at the end of the day. I'm not an investor.
Suleiman, do you have a bottom line?
Well, yes. CDC Group is actually ultimately a development finance arm, but we do look at financing private equity. I mean, sorry, private investments, private ventures. And I mean, I think our measure is job creation. So out of our portfolio of 1,300 companies, they support 1.1 million direct jobs. So we do measure that. But on that conditionality, we recognize that sustainability has to be because it's commercially viable. So although we have a very low return expectation, we're saying that if we can actually make sure that companies do well, we would do well as well. And I think that is, I think everyone here is sort of attributing logic to the same thing of saying, if your expectation, it's about your expectation. I mean, I look at my son. He comes home with a B. The question then becomes, do you pat him on the back if he's an A potential child, or do you actually push him to say, you know what, that was great, but we want to expect more? I think a lot of the problem that comes into like the African environment is that when we talk about Africa, we suddenly almost transpose it into this magical bubble of mediocre expectations and mediocrity, where we have very excellent people. We have very capable, very ambitious people. And we should demand as much and more from them. And as you demonstrates, is that when you actually demand that from them, they deliver. And so I think that's what it is about. We're all on the same page, and I think what it is talking about how do we get alignment to make sure that the processes of softer money, support, the lending helping hand, actually filters in to more of the hard-nosed sort of money. Because ultimately, all investment in Africa is impactful. And so we need to make sure, how do we make sure that it isn't a discrete, you're either in the donor category or you're in the private sector category. And unfortunately, that is what a lot of companies in their early stages have to choose. And I give an example. Yesterday, we were in a panel, and we had a great company that we're sort of looking at business model, what have you, and they're saying, oh, we need X amount of money. And we're saying, okay, that sounds great. And they're saying, yeah, but because we're donor-funded, if we get an investor in, they're not allowed to ask for the money back. They can't get a return. And so we're saying, well, then why are you here in entrepreneurial engagement? Because frankly, no investor, impact or otherwise, is going to sit there and say, we're not going to demand anything of you. So I think we have to get better at aligning all of our interests. At the end of the day, we are all trying to achieve development. We're all trying to achieve sustainable business. And we need to align that soft money. So I think where you've got money, capital, ourselves, USA, don't have you, aligning it so that it becomes investable for more traditional money, it works. I think where you have programs that sort of focus on the objective of whether it's outreach of number of people and forget the business itself, that is where we're breeding mediocrity.
We only have about 5 minutes left. So questions, please keep them short. Don't give us a long story. And direct your question to someone if you have one. No questions? Yes. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for all the wonderful inputs. And so I was really thinking as you are all discussing, and I would love to hear your thoughts on the place of the customer in all the discussion, whether it's soft money or hard money, because at the end of the day, an entrepreneur wants money to build products and services that they can sell to somebody. So where do you place the customer in Africa and the attitudes and the context of that customer? for the entrepreneur, because they have to sell to this customer. And when you look at ideas, it really determines at what stage is a customer willing to buy this product or willing to buy this service. And that really dictates whether it's soft money or whether it's hard money.
Do you want to talk about a customer, someone who's consuming megawatts? Do you think it matters to the customer whether their product is being funded by or invested in by their company is being invested in by soft money or hard money? Is that the question?
I think it's the challenge of working with a poor clientele, I think, is you have to have soft money to serve a different target base if that's your goal.
Yes, because it really, I think it kind of matters at what stage your business or your idea is. And so perhaps looking from a customer's perspective, at what point will they be willing to buy that product or buy that service from the entrepreneur? And that being the case, then it dictates whether they take soft money to be able to build something and then maybe take hard money later. But then I think the context has to be really put in place in the discussion and the discourse as we're looking at soft money or hard money for entrepreneurs, and ultimately the customer that is going to buy those products and how they behave and their attitudes.
I think there's something that I'm not sure I get it completely, but maybe I try. The issue here is really whether you should subsidize the end product to the consumer or not. Yeah? And that the question there is, are you subsidizing the company such that it can grow to a certain scale where it becomes profitable, or actually are you subsidizing the actual cost of the product to the consumer? And the danger with subsidizing the product, the cost of the product to the consumer, is that you can't go to scale. But the more you go, the more you lose money, et cetera, and you haven't got a real product. So it's better, I think, to look at it in terms of, well, what is the gross margin? Is the gross margin on this product satisfactory such that if you scaled up the company by 3, then the company is profitable and this thing is sustainable? Or is it the case that your subsidy has to be an ongoing subsidy, otherwise it doesn't work? And if it's the latter, I think you've got a problem.
If I look at some of the work we do with women entrepreneurs, and there can be some data about, especially when it comes to debt capital, investors are always looking at who's your market and what relationship do you have with that market and what gives you an edge within that market. So nobody likes, for instance, when we were helping our bank, the bank kind of was, it was trying to compare itself with other banks that had been there. And they said, we do SME, we do corporate banking, we do retail banking. And investors were like, you know what, you've got to choose. You can't really play and beat people that have been in this field for a long time and have built those channels. The way your market looks, the way your branches are, you're targeting this particular segment, and they have to believe. Does your team reflect that essence? So if you're going for the, is it low end, does your team reflect that? If you're going for a particular segment and you have people there, or women, for instance, that don't know how to deal with them, they may not be confident enough to present some certain aspect, and you don't have people that are sensitized to that, then change the team. In that case, your business model reflects that you are going to be successful with the segment that you're focused in. So it is something that's considered when people are doing sort of due diligence, but whether the customer at the end of the day cares whether the money is soft or hard, I think they're oblivious.
Mark, do you have something to
say? Yeah, no, briefly, I actually agree with both points. I mean, we don't want to subsidize the customer. I think by subsidizing the business, where you can have a double or a triple bottom line, to me makes sense, right? So I want to grow the entrepreneur for the sake of growing the entrepreneur. That's why most of you are here. It grows economic growth in Africa. It helps build the base. It builds companies. We don't know the potential. There's a fantastic potential. I want to unlock the bottom line of the fact that you might grow your business and actually be an employer. So that kind of false adage for me a little bit about entrepreneurial versus getting a job. At the end of the day, I hope all of you become people who hire people and people get jobs, right? So it's not one or the other. There are different ways to get into a same end. But finally, if that product that you're doing is veterinary services or solar home kits or things like that, then I got a triple bottom line. Then I got a whole bunch of people I'm already targeting to try to help struggling in difficult situations, having a more inexpensive product that I need to get them anyway. Now they have power and they're not burning kerosene in their homes. Now they have veterinary services and their cattle are dying. So for me, it's not a softer subsidy thing. I mean, I wouldn't want to give soft money to that person to say, because you're so important, I want to give you money and you got to grow. It would be the same rigor everyone else is talking about. But it would be part of an ecosystem. For me, that would be a really good place for me to be subsidized money, aka I'm subsidy whenever I'm involved, to help move the ecosystem to get to that triple bottom line.
Any
one
more question? Any social entrepreneurs in the room?
Hi, my name is Saskia Reus. I'm an integrated program for APA for All on water sanitation and solid waste. And I think if you look into soft capital, I think we also need to look into what kind of gap we support. So there's a gap for entrepreneurs. We're ready for investors. So we should start with the criteria of the investors. When are you ready to come on board? Is it cash flow positive innovation? Does a team to be in place? What kind of things the company needs to achieve to be ready to scale up? So if we have soft capital to use and we support also pilots, we should start with the criteria of the investor and work backwards and see how we can get there. So, and that is also my request to the investor community, how can we help you to come on board in earlier stages, look at more risky kind of deal flow, and how can we help you to get on board? What do you need? In-depth TA expertise in the sector, domain expertise, networks, launching customers.
You have a question?
Yeah, so the question is, how can we engage more investors to use this soft capital to scale up entrepreneurs?
Yeah. From the point of view of the ACN, we see ourselves as a feeder fund that is not there to compete, but to find, surface, get those businesses going. And then we have a unit called ACF Connect, which is exactly as you're describing, right? Where that unit is to take the growing businesses after 3 years or so and actually help them raise commercial capital. Teach them how to speak to investors, help them prepare their case for investors, take them through the investment process, and then leverage in commercial money. And we only put that in place a couple of years ago, and we're 8 years old now, because we very much recognize what you're saying. It's all very well being a feeder fund, but you've got to do more than that. You've got to be an active feeder fund, which is bringing the investor to the business and helping the business get ready for the investor. But we find that's much more effective to do when we've had a business with us for 3 years, we've helped it get to a certain stage, it's put in as much money as it can do alongside ours, and now it's grown up and it's ready for some serious investment. We get a far higher return on our engagement with the investment community at that point, because we've done the sick thing, in a sense, and we know which businesses are ready, and we can help them go the last mile.
Yeah, okay. As I said, much as I hated to sort of involve the institution that I'm representing, I do think that this is an interesting point in that CDC group itself determined that, okay, much as we're patient capital, we're looking at sort of investable businesses, we do recognize that some of these companies need that intervention to help them to scale up into a position where, as you says, commercial capital becomes interesting. So what we did last year is we put aside 45 million pounds as a pilot to say, okay, let's co-invest with people in essentially startup businesses with great concepts, great management, great people, and then work leveraging our experience in terms of being able to set in place processes, systems, guidance, the support and all of the things around the entrepreneur to see how well we can achieve that. Having achieved into that and invested in that, we suddenly realized that it was so successful that we this year increased it to 300 million pounds. And we're actually engaged now to say, how do we actually work with the UK government and other people who are co-partners to actually bring that, should I say, rigor to the softer money to make sure that it does become a route to market, a route to be able to attract, as you highlight, the more commercial investors. So I think there's a lot of innovation even in the sort of soft money space that has been happening, particularly around the last 5 years, where people are getting more cognizant of the fact that if we can introduce that rigor, understand what the end market needs, as they say, the end commercial investor, and work towards nurturing our entrepreneurs to get there, we will actually have quite a bit of success.
Can we take one more question? No. I'm sorry. I do want to say thank you so much to our panelists. Unfortunately, I only know you by first name, unfortunately. This is a token of appreciation from SunCalc, Suleiman, Mark, Hugh, and Andrea. Thank you very much for
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.